Hey Louis, thank you so much for coming to the Nokolopo channel. I am super excited to hear how you built Read Something Great. And I want to actually learn from this experience a lot. Like, how do you build great stuff in Bubble? Even though it sounds simple, like you hit something, you get something beautiful. So how did you do it? How did we go? I want to explore that with you. So let's begin.
Where should we start? I mean, Read Something Great was initially started off as like a very fun side project. That's one of the fun things about Bubble. Like, it's got so much versatility that you can start somewhere and, you know, move off in any direction based on what your users are telling you. So Read Something Great literally started over a weekend where I figured I wanted to build a platform to help writers that I thought were good find audiences without having to, like, you know, blast it out to their own Twitter following or hope that someone else does it. And yeah, I mean, it seems to have picked up. It's a very simple app. It just gives you five things to read at a time across different categories. And if you don't like any of the five things, you can press a button and it gives you five more things. So that's at its core, that's it. And its core has remained unchanged for a while. However, I've added a bunch of new features that people seem to like as well.
Awesome. I mean, that sounds super fun, right? Just read five things at a time. If not, just hit a button. It's like, it feels like an arcade somehow, but you know.
Yeah, I think there's beauty in simplicity, right? Like in the world today, like, there's so much information at all points of time hitting us from all sides. One of my just core beliefs is that less is very often more. We just have to figure out in what aspects of our life that is true. And I think information overload is one of those where if you can either curate things or, you know, create like artificial intelligence that can curate it for people, that's useful today and it's only going to be more useful in the future. And I think that sort of subconsciously drove me towards designing this.
Awesome. So can you share, like, you know, can you share your screen and kind of show us how and where it started? Any design thought process that you had? Anything that you planned ahead? Would love to see them.
Sure. One second. Let me just share my entire screen. Can you see my whole screen?
Yep.
Okay. Let me first take you to the app. And for folks that haven't seen it before, which I'm assuming will be most folks since it's still a very small app, this is what it looks like. It's a single page app for the most part. You've got five articles under five categories. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's it. If you don't like what you see here, all you can do is click a button and it will find five new articles for you. If you feel like reading something, you can click on this button and it will open it up for you. If you've read something, you can click on this button and it will mark it as read for you. You can also save stuff to bookmarks and then look at all your bookmarks and stuff in your profile. There's one new feature that I added as well, which is called snippets, which came from the fact that the preview of every article sometimes didn't show all the good parts of it. So this kind of lets you see certain bits of the article that I found extremely interesting. And you can read them as, you know, individual snippets and keep changing them as well. And as and when you feel like going to the article, you can then click on the article and go over and read the entire thing. The last thing I'd like to mention before I get into the building of the app is that I recently also built a nice dark mode, if I may say so myself.
So cool.
Completely from scratch, first time ever, just purely with like a bunch of YouTube plus Pinterest sort of tips. And yeah, I can go through some of that as well. Now what I'll do is I will take you to my Bubble app. This is, should I do a walkthrough right now?
Yeah, we can proceed to walkthrough. Yes. Yeah.
Cool. So for anyone not familiar with Bubble, Bubble is basically, in my opinion, the most flexible no-code tool out there. It also happens to be the most complex to get started on. But that's a trade-off that they had to have made in order to give you the functionality that they give you. So it's worth investing the first, you know, 1 or 2 weeks just to understand what is happening in the entire interface, because at the moment, at least, the interface is very dated. It's not as slick as some of the other no-code tools. But anyway, There are three main parts to any bubble app, and I'll take you through each of those very briefly within my app. One is the design, which is your front end, which is what you're looking at right now. So this is the front end in the editor for my app. Two is the data, which is your back end. So everything that has to do with the information that your app is using in order to run sits in the data section of it. And three is the workflow, which is what connects the front and the back, what connects your design, your front end, with your data, which is your back end, and what happens in between. So for example, each of these squares that you see here are basically workflows that define what happens when something in the front end happens. So if a user clicks on something, this is what the app will do to the data, etc. So that's the design tab. The workflow tab. So yeah, I'll take you from the front end. I'll start with the front end at least. This is largely a one-page app, so I'll take you through the first page itself. If you look at it from here, like this part is always unchanging, which is what you see in the app as well, like this top little bit. And after that is where the fun starts. So if you notice in the app, I've got two tabs here. Like there's one called articles and one called snippets. And if you look at the app itself, this is what happens. You click on snippets, it switches. You click on articles, it switches here as well. In order to make this happen smoothly, where both things turn up right up top, I've used a fairly basic feature where I just have a conditional on a certain group. Madhuri, feel free to stop me if I'm going.
No, all good. This is perfect. Yeah.
Cool. So let me just find these groups, unhide them. So as you can see now, we've got two groups. There's this big red one up top, which is the snippets group, and there's the rest right below it, which is your articles group. How I choose to display these two groups is based on which of these two tabs is selected.
Yeah.
So for example, when a person clicks the snippet tab, if you go to the workflow and see what happens there, there is a custom state, that is a bubble specific terminology for data that you store on the page. It is not as complicated as it sounds. It can be intimidating at the start, but with a couple of YouTube videos, you'll figure what that means. But essentially, when someone clicks on snippets, there's a custom state workflow that gets triggered that changes the state of that page to snippets. And if you go to the snippets tab, you'll find that when the display of the page is set to snippets, so when the custom state is snippets, this element is visible. So it shows this whole group, this whole red group. And it does the exact opposite for the second tab. So when it's not snippets, it shows. And when it is snippets, it doesn't show.
Nice.
Now, within these two tabs, again, there are sub elements. So in this group, you've got one big one here, one big one here, and another medium-sized one here. The big one here is the one that shows you the snippets. So if you go to the app, switch back to Lightroom. This here is the snippet that I'm showing you. Every time you press this button, it changes the snippet, and it also changes the one at the bottom. The one at the bottom is nothing except the article from which this snippet was taken. So the goal here being that if somebody reads a snippet that they're interested in, they can then figure out whether or not they want to read the article and click on it, and then be redirected to that. So I'll take you through a brief sort of functionality of this particular bit. It's not very complicated. It's a single group. And the source of the group is, in Bubble's terms, again, like parent group snippets. What is the parent group of this group? It is this. And this group is getting data basically from a random item in my database, which is a table in this case. Now, this app that I've built is a very dumb app. It's not got any funky algorithms. Like, you can build this in a day's time if you know exactly what you want to build. I'm using just a random function. Like, it's just generating a random snippet. So once it does that, that particular snippet shows up here. And then I've got each element here that displays a particular aspect of that snippet. So this one gives you the text, which I've called learning, which should actually be renamed for the starter of the snippets. This one gives you the category of that snippet. This here is a button that lets you tweet out the snippet.
Nice.
And this here lets you save it to your profile.
Awesome.
I won't go into details of tweeting and I could show you the Twitter one because it's an interesting workflow if you want to see that. If you ever want to like create a Twitter sort of bot, or not a bot, but like a workflow.
Yeah.
This is a fun way to do it. I use a plugin which opens an external website. And for anyone, you can screenshot this later. This is the Twitter URL and the characters that you use to put spaces into that. Combine that with the group's data. So it changes dynamically based on which snippet is being displayed. And likewise for this as well, it's not too complicated. For the second part, which is the main display when you open up the app, which is the articles display, which is this thing that you see here.
Yeah.
This is slightly more complicated. This is a repeating group. Actually, no, this isn't a repeating group, sorry. It looks like a repeating group, but it's a fake repeating group. Because each of these five things are being filtered based on a category.
Yeah.
So the categories are fixed. I've got, if you notice, there's a difference between this text here, which clearly shows a category saying living better, and this text here, which is dynamically changing based on what data I'm feeding this particular group.
Understood.
And all these five are identical, except for the category changing. So how it behaves is identical to each other, except it looks up different categories.
Got it.
So if I go into this is another interesting bit, which is how does it decide what article to show me? One is, yes, it does show you a random article. But the list is also filtered for a couple of things, because there are certain users that don't want to see an article again. Or there are people that mark an article as read and don't want to see that again because I've already read it. So there's a fun thing I discovered recently where if you click on the filter, if you filter a database, there's an option called advanced, which lets you do more advanced things, as the name suggests, than the usual filters that you put in. This is not a plugin, this is just within Bubble itself. So this is where I filter for articles that people have already read or articles that they've said that they're not interested in.
Yeah.
So that those don't show up immediately. And yeah, I mean, that's pretty much the skeleton of the app. Like, that's how it works. Each of these have like individual workflows. So for example, if you go to the workflow tab, you'll see a bunch of these, but all of these aren't very complicated. They're all very similar to each other. They're just for different groups. So this one and this one, all the red ones are the same, because those are basically for these guys. So it's not complicated at all once you figure out what you want to build. However, like figuring out what you want to build is arguably the more difficult part, because you can have the best, like, I don't know, tools in the world, but if you don't know how to use them, the tools are quite pointless. And I think that's one of the beauty of like no code versus code, where in code they kind of, you're more specialized. Like, it's very rare that you find a full stack developer who's also a good designer, because the amount of effort it takes to actually become good at each of these things is huge.
Yes.
Whereas in no code, you could be a full stack no code developer and designer, because the codes are abstracting a lot of that effort on your behalf. Yes, you won't have the functionality that a proper developer has, but you'll also be able to build stuff and iterate way faster than, and have a lot more fun doing it, because you have full control from design to execution and iteration in the future.
Yeah. Awesome. I mean, this is a pretty detailed walkthrough of how it was built. So I learned something new today. Definitely the randomized list. So that's really exciting.
Yeah. I mean, people ask me if there's an algorithm. Like, I don't know how to make an algorithm. But it's
you
funny
made
to
the algorithm. An algorithm, technically, you made one.
No, it's funny to think like so. That's the beauty of no code again, right? Like, so many people are DM me asking you, okay, what front end, what back end language, like, you know, what stack are you using? And I'm just like, I use Bubble and I use Airtable as my back end. Like,
wow.
Like, they might laugh at me, but like, I'm very happy that they thought I wasn't using it. Like, the very fact that they think I built it with code means that it's like the gap is closing between code, you know, coding and not coding.
Yeah, I mean, it's more evident that, you know, at the end of the day, as a human being, you look at something, you can't decipher if it's code or no code, right?
Yeah, yeah. And honestly, if you're building in no code, I would encourage you to like not talk about no code outside of the no code community. I think no code is a great way to get people to start building. But once they start building, like, don't say it was built without code. Like, just let people get food and like smile when they do.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. A lot of times we've given solutions where people feel, okay, is this really built in Webflow? I can't believe it's done in Webflow, right? You know, it goes in that trajectory, and yours is proof that, you know, people are able to not able to distinguish that, and, you know, kind of like go beyond that fear that everything should be done with code. I can also dabble with, you know, Bubble or something like that. So that's good. That's really good.
Yep.
Awesome. So one final thing I do want to kind of like understand from you is, so you've started out with, say, a single page app on Bubble and stuff like that. It's a fun play project, right? So if you are adding new features and stuff like that, like you started to do with snippets, and last I remember, it was just a simple reading list, right? Now it's So when you are thinking of adding new features, is there like an overhaul of the design and the whole workflow that you have to do, or do you plan for it ahead?
So I've learned the hard way that if you are thinking of building something, don't just build it immediately. Think, especially as the thing gets more complex, like in the early days, that's okay. You know, one thing can affect only the next domino, but once you have like 10 dominoes standing next to each other, you have to think of like, okay, what will happen to the 10th guy if I change this first thing? So as your app gets more complex, like, slow down how quickly you decide to execute a new idea. Like, make sure you're thinking through it properly. Having said that though, like, it's still a lot easier to do that and reverse it when you're using a no-code tool than it is if you were going to like code. So like, I would encourage you to keep thinking about ideas. Like right now, what I do is whenever I have a new idea, I do exactly what I said. I think about, okay, what all will have to change in order for this thing to, you know, become what I want it to become. And sometimes things will have to change, and then you have to think about, okay, is it worth the change? Like, will this confuse people? Will it, you know, annoy them a little bit that, you know, I removed something that was there earlier, I moved it to a different place? And sometimes if those answers are no, then like, do it, otherwise don't do it. Having said that, also though, like, it's very difficult to judge how people will react. So at least when you're building in no code initially, like, build for yourself. Don't, like, unless you have to build for someone else, and that's I'm not an expert at that. I'm not an expert at this either, but I have a little bit of experience. Just like, build what feels right to you as, and make yourself your own user, at least in the early days, so you get that core thing right. And there will be people who will, you know, suggest, okay, change this, add that. And like, you can politely tell them no, because you can't go in 20 different directions. You have to pick one. And the best one to pick is just the one that you yourself like.
That makes a lot of sense, actually. And it feels more of a product direction rather than, you know, the capability of a no code tool. In all honesty, that's what it feels like, right? So have you faced a scenario yet in your Bubble experience that you felt that maybe this can't be done, right? Or maybe it's too outrageous, something like that. Did you have a scenario?
So Bubble, the biggest problem I have with Bubble at the moment is just speed. I don't know if it's because I've not structured my database as well as I should have, or if it's something else, but I wish it was faster. That's one big thing. And like, folks have told me to like have an algorithm, and at some point I'm like, okay, maybe I should try and have a basic one. And I don't know how to do that with Bubble. Maybe there is a way, but I have no clue. And the last thing, like, I think payments in Bubble is not as simple or straightforward as it is in other tools. Although I think it's still very much possible. A lot of folks have done it easily. But it's not like, you know, click a button and you can now get paid like Shopify or whatever. It's not like that. So yeah, I mean, small complaints, but I love the tool. Like, if anyone's thinking of getting into no code, like, Bubble might not be the best first tool to try out if you've never built something before, but like, make sure it's the second tool you try out if it's not the first.
solid advice that is super helpful. Thank you so much for sharing this, and I really can't wait to see what more you ship and rate something great next. Thank you.
Yeah,
so
I mean,